Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the online service from Gordon United Church. We welcome you here, and this service is brought to you by the Affirming Committee of the Church. Today's service is going to be including the members of the committee, Pat Larry and Andrea Koscheck, the co-chairs, Ray Green, Rose Justice, Addison and Joshua Lee as distant advisors, and Reverend Heidi Koscheck as our spiritual advisor. Prior to the COVID, we had conducted three separate educational sessions for the congregation. They included watching the documentary For the Bible Tells Me So and two group participation sessions. We will be starting further sessions as soon as it is safe to do so. This morning, I wanted to address the question that comes up frequently about the affirming process, and that is, why becoming an affirming church when we are such a welcoming congregation? I have taken my answer directly from the United Church document, Open Hearts, on affirming ministries to help us to see the difference. Affirming ministries are communities of faith, regional councils, assisted living homes, educational institutions, retreat centers, outdoor ministries, and other ministries within the United Church that publicly, and that's the important word, that publicly declare the commitment to the inclusion and justice for people of all sexual orientations and gender identities. Although affirming ministries make an explicit statement about issues of sexuality and gender, their commitment to justice is far broader. They continually grow and change as they seek to live more fully in God's way of welcome, love, and justice for all creation. Just as God rejoices in the goodness and diversity of creation, so too affirming ministries honor and celebrate diversity. We hope to see you all at our next session. Long before my people journeyed to this land, the Kungwin's people were here, and they received from their elders an understanding of creation and of the mystery that surrounds us, all that was deep and rich and to be treasured. When they shared their vision, my people did not hear. My people tried to force Indigenous peoples to be like us, and in so doing, we helped to destroy the vision that made them what they were. We are in the midst of a long and painful journey as we reflect on the cries that our church did not or would not hear, and how we have behaved as a church. As we travel this difficult road of repentance, reconciliation, and healing, we commit ourselves to work toward ensuring that we will never again use our power as a church to hurt others with attitudes of racial and spiritual superiority. We pray that all Indigenous people will hear the sincerity of our words today, and they will witness the living out of our apology in our actions and in the future. We're going to light the Christ candle. We light this candle honoring the one who said, "I am the light."
Thank you. In this Epiphany time, we will not keep silent, we will not rest. Our vindication shines out like the new dawn. Light a path for us, O God, that we may move into new relationships. We have been called by you into new ways of being. Your torch has been passed to us. In you, our light has come. We are not forsaken. We are not desolate. In you, O God, we find our delight. Let glory be on our lips as we delight in your presence. Inspire us, God, as we offer our worship. Let us sing hymn, Will You Come and See the Light? Voices United, 96. Join me in the opening prayer. With open minds and open hearts, we come before you, God. You have shared tremendous news with us, news of the birth of Jesus, news of his baptism, news so incredible that it cannot be contained. We bring together all our resources, all that we are, all that we have to share the good news. We are called to be more. We are called to be a community of faith. We are called to be the church. We realize how we have misused the gifts of your spirit at times. When life is happening so fast, we act and speak before thinking. We have caused harm by our off-the-cuff remarks. Our actions have led to exclusion. Knowingly and unknowingly, we have caused harm. Forgive our ignorance and our mistakes. Be with us now as we discern your calling and our discipleship. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. God watches. God listens to our confessions. God responds out of unconditional love. Allow the Spirit to embrace you and know that you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hello. At this part of the service, as you know, we always do a learning together segment. And I get the privilege this week of doing this segment. As you can see, I'm here all by myself. That's why I have no mask on. So the people you see on the video with no mask, they have been doing the recordings on their own at home. I'm in the church office, but Everyone that is together doing things like singing in the sanctuary, we all wear our masks for that and keep each other safe. So learning together is supposedly for the children in the congregation, but I know that the adults always enjoy these things too. They always enjoy the lesson, they always enjoy the surprises. So in this series, we are exploring epiphany boxes. My epiphany box is not wrapped as nicely as everyone else's was. My box is a little bit of a wreck, actually, but it's pretty. It's still pretty. See? So what do you think is in it? Last couple of weeks, the gift in the box was a cup of water. And that's such an important gift because so many people in the world don't have clean water to drink. So we recognize what a great gift that is. But this is not water. It's very light. Let's just see what's in here. My turn to open the epiphany box. What's in here? You know what this is? That's a brain. I think we know that's what, well, that's maybe not exactly what our brains look like, but that's a good picture of a brain. And a brain, we each have one, and it allows us to think, right? It allows us to think. It also allows us to learn new things. So we grow up, we learn the difference between right and wrong. And when we learn something new, maybe we have to change what we thought about before. And that's that. The brain allows us to do that. So that is an awesome gift. Really good one. What else is in this box? Here we go. We have feet and hands. So this is a good gift too, because say we discover something wrong is happening and we know it's wrong, and maybe it's happening to our friend at school or something like that. We can use our feet and go over there, and we can use our hands and we can help. We can fix situations and make a difference because we can take action. I think that's the message. And that's a really great gift. Not everybody has feet and hands, but I think we all use our gifts as much as we can to the extent that we have things to use, tools to use. Oh, this is the best gift of all. This, ready? Yeah. It's a heart. We like to do that. So they're doing, let's see, they're using it that way. Most of the time we do this, right? My heart's kind of funny. So a heart, and every one of us has one. A heart is love, right? It means love. And it's the love that is in us. It's the love that we receive all the time as a gift from God. And the great thing about this gift is you can give it away all day. You can give your love, can give all your love away every day. And the very next day you wake up and you are full of love again, because you know, it's never ending. Right? So that is an awesome gift. These are really cool gifts, wonderful gifts. All right. Lesson over for the moment. We're going to sing a song, and this song is my favorite from when I was a child and I would go to church with my parents. And I think you'll find, if you ask the adults that you're sitting around, and maybe it's your parents or grandparents or older siblings or even older friends, they probably all really love this song as well. It's called Jesus Bids Us Shine, and it's in Voices United. It is number 585, and the words will be on the screen, so sing along.
Jesus bids us shine with a pure, clear light, like a little candle burning in the night. In this world of darkness, oh, let us shine, you in your small corner and I in mine. Jesus bids us shine, first of all, for him. Well, he sees and knows it. Jesus walks beside us to help us shine, you in your small corner and I in mine. Jesus bids us shine then for all around. Many kinds of darkness in the world are found, sin and want and sorrow, so we must shine.
First scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 1 to 11, spiritual gifts. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, "Let Jesus be cursed." And no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another, the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. And to another, faith by the same Spirit, and to another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles, to another, prophecy, to another, the discernment of spirits, and to another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. Our second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verse 1 to 11. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that of you or to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it had come from, though the servants who drew the wine knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him.
Flip Wilson was a comedian who had a very popular variety show on television in the 1970s. He developed several characters of the show, including Reverend Leroy, the minister of the Church of What's Happening Now. During one skit, Reverend Leroy was trying to energize the people, and create some enthusiasm in the congregation. So in his sermon, he hit the pulpit and he said, "If this church is going to get anywhere, it has to learn to crawl." The congregation sat up and took notice and replied, "Let it crawl, Rev, let it crawl." Then he said, "And after it learns to crawl, it has to learn to walk." And the people, getting a little excited, said rather loudly, "Let it walk, Rev, let it walk." Then he got excited and waving his hands in the air, he said, "After this church learns to walk, it has to learn to run." By now, several members of the congregation were on their feet yelling, "Let it run, Rev, let it run." And then, almost dancing, he said, "If this church is going to run, it's going to take money." And the people standing fell to their seats and said very softly, "Let it crawl, Rev, let it crawl."
They have no wine, Mary tells Jesus. It is Mary's responsibility, or does she just want to help? And then, what's with Jesus's cryptic answer? "Woman, what concern is that of to you and to me?" It's as though he's saying it's none of our business. Who talks to their mother that way? If I were to address my mother as woman in this way, I'd need healing shortly thereafter, because that kind of disrespect would not be tolerated. This is a conversation that really needs facial expression. So Jesus looks at his mother, and what did he look like? Mad? Stern? I can picture Mary with her hand in the air, palm towards Jesus, as if saying, "Talk to the hand," while she says to the steward, "Do whatever he says." Was it the little push by someone who knew Jesus better than anyone else? Was Jesus prepared to let things crawl along? Do we have Mary to thank for the best wine? Was it Mary's push that got Jesus walking? His ministry had to start somewhere, so why not here? With a feast where there is joy and happiness and laughter, where people are enjoying each other's company.
James Dabbs remembers what life was like growing up in South Carolina, where he describes religion as the opposite of life. Religion was a day and a place. Religion was Sunday and the church. Almost everything else was life. Religion was a curious, quiet, inconsequential moment in the vital existence of a country boy. It came around every week, but it didn't seem to have much to do with the rest of life, that is, with life. Jesus' ministry was about life, about a God who puts joy into life, a God who revels in celebration, a God who never wants that celebration to end. It was never intended to be a once-a-week thing. It was always meant to be an everyday thing.
Jewish weddings in Jesus's time were steeped in tradition and ritual. One of the customs was providing an extravagant feast for guests. Something went wrong at this wedding, however, because they ran out of wine early. In that culture, such a miscalculation would have been a great humiliation for the new husband and wife. There are those that interpret the lack of wine as symbolism, the spiritual dryness of the people. Wine was a common symbol of God's bounty and of spiritual joy. Not only did Jesus produce a large quantity of wine, but the quality of it astonished the banquet master. In the same way, Jesus pours his spirit into us in abundance, giving us God's best. Let it run, Reverend, let it run.
At times, we have forgotten the miracle of Cana, yet our mission and service stories show us over and over again that new things are possible, that transformation is just waiting to happen, and we can start from very simple, even ordinary beginnings. Harry Stewart and Chris Southern described the beginnings of Rainbow Camp in Northern Ontario. Initially, we wanted to bridge the local LGBTQ community with area churches. We started the association, and then we launched the camp. We had no idea what we were doing at the time. Only one person on the board had camp experience, but we knew that young people would benefit, says Southern. Originally a one-week camp with 14 youth, Rainbow Camp now serves up to 50 youth each week for 4 weeks. Expansion plans are in the works over the next couple of years. Rainbow Camp will pilot on the East and West coasts. We've had an invitation to duplicate the Rainbow Camp experience in Australia and in the UK too. It's exciting, says Stuart. Above all, Rainbow Camp provides campers with a safe space to be who they are without judgment. I'll never forget our first year of camp. It was the second full day. A camper told us his mom had found a dress in his closet. He lied to her and said that it belonged to his girlfriend. He had brought the dress to camp and said he would like to wear it. High heels and sand don't mix, Stuart explains, laughing. But the warmth, love, and compassion that the camper received from everyone at the camp was amazing. We tell all of our staff, your job is to make sure that each and every camper has the best possible time at Rainbow Camp. Southern and Stuart say they want the camp experience to be memorable, fun, soul-searching, and supportive. We don't want any camper to feel afraid to be who they are. I think that's why so many now call it their home. Hundreds of lives have been changed as a result. Jesus pours his spirit into us in abundance, giving us God's best. Let it run, Reverend, let it run.
Nearly 2 years ago, COVID-19 sparked a global pandemic as borders closed, as families became quarantined, as the world was asked to isolate. A virus knows no boundary. It doesn't care if you are rich or poor. COVID-19 showed no bias, prejudice, or discrimination as it ravaged our world. It would have been easy to let things crawl along to retreat to our homes, close the doors, shut out the world, and look after our own. That would have been forgetting Cana. That would have been the world saying we have run out of wine. Instead, that same virus showed what the global village is capable of. When churches closed and the economy was in a tailspin, people reached out to their neighbors, from balcony to balcony, porch to porch, backyard to backyard. There was concern about the church's programs and ministries, food banks, hot meals, and shelters, and concern across the country from community ministries like Rainbow Camp. Now, Rainbow Camp continues to provide friendship and support year-round through Rainbow Online Connection, and the founders have been recognized with a Governor General's Award. Amazingly, the same time as people were laid off or losing their jobs around the country, many valuable programs continued to be funded. The buildings and even some of the programs closed, but the church's mission did not stop. generosity abounded. The internet and platforms like Zoom and Microsoft Teams and FaceTime and YouTube made sure we didn't run out of wine. Even during that tragedy and shared grief, we didn't forget Canna.
Here at Gordon United, our volunteer phone team have been busy keeping in touch with those who don't have email or the capacity to engage with online ministries, as well as just generally checking in with people to see how they're doing. Audio recordings and print copies of services are delivered, emailed, or mailed out. Faith at Home resources have been delivered to every family with children in the congregation. An evening reflection has been added to the weekly worship offerings. We continue to provide a space for 12-step groups and for childcare to continue. And for a while there, our dedicated choir was able to offer music once again. In place of some of our other outreach offerings, we have gotten involved with the Coldest Night of the Year walk. We have changed and moved and pivoted and adapted, and we're still here and still offering ministry.
Generosity still abounds. We haven't forgotten Canna, and so we need to be celebrating constantly. At Canna, they keep the best wine for last, and for us, the best is yet to come. The same God who was with Jesus in Canna wants to generously continue the feast. The community of faith is to be celebrated of people. We need to be always celebrating people, sharing around a common table, offering signs of affirmation, giving thanks to God. Sharing our energies, our excitement, our joy, and yes, our money. Because if this church is going to run, it's going to take money. And the people said, let it run, Reverend, let it run. We hope. After all, our energy, our excitement, our joy, all flow from our God.
Jesus' mother was not content to let things crawl. She told Jesus to do something about the lack of wine. Jesus was not content to let things walk. He turned water into wine, and it was a lot of wine, an abundance of wine. It was a sign of what Jesus' ministry would be about, a helping ministry, a healing ministry, a teaching ministry. It is also a sign of what our ministry is about, to invite the world to pull up a chair, to generously toast the overflowing abundance of God's love. And the people said, let it run, Reverend, let it run. Amen.
As we consider our gift spirit, let us take time to remember the gift to the United Church Hospital Chaplaincy. Our chaplains offer much needed pastoral care in times of the family crisis and the urgent medical needs. Patients, family, nurses, doctors, and staff are offered a listening ear and a prayer. We also lift up to the ministry of our pastoral care team and our phoners who connect with people on a regular basis. Where families cannot be together on a daily basis due to distance, our team provide much needed support. Let us consider the gift of pastoral care as we offer ourselves and our resources. And we give thanks.
Lord, listen to your children pray. Lord, send your spirit.
Let us pray. Wondrous God, who continues to share with us the gifts of the Spirit, help us to accept these gifts and use them in your kingdom. Where wisdom is offered, enable us to hear it. Your wisdom is sometimes discerned through unexpected people and in unexpected places. Let wisdom speak on behalf of those struggling to find a voice or where their voices have been stifled in a cacophony of political jargon and rhetoric. Let wisdom burst forth, shouting your truth in a chaotic world. May the gift of knowledge continue to guide us as we move through our days. Let it inform and challenge us to discover a new approach to food for God's people. May foodstuffs move from being hoarded by a few to being shared equally, that have-not people and families in our own community be offered nourishment for their bodies and nourishment for their spiritual lives, without regard to faith or denomination. Let knowledge be shared through advocacy. Help us confront barriers that hurt and oppress, that everyone may receive a living wage, enabling a sense of dignity and pride. With the coronavirus pandemic still in our thoughts, we offer prayers for the gift of healing, O God. May those trained in a variety of specialties use their skills to heal where possible, to offer hope where needed, to offer peace freely, to offer comfort for the dying. We offer thanks for those donations that have enabled safe needle exchange sites and medical attention given at street level for those who find themselves homeless. May healing of the mind be as important as healing of the body. Thank you, God, that we continue to learn, to research, to develop new ways of offering healing. We pray for the gift of prophecy, God. Listening to Jeremiah, Ruth, Micah, we learn of you, O God. We learn about your commitment to humanity. We learn of your unconditional love freely offered to all. Through the prophetic words of Jesus, we hear about the kind of community that you call us to make. Help us, God, to make our own prophetic voices. Empower us to speak out when we see injustice, when we witness oppression, where inequality continues. Guide us, God, as we use our voices to share your story in our time and context. We pray for those who are sick, awaiting or recovering from surgery or treatment. Some of the names, although certainly not all, Dave L., Lois, Melissa, Richard, Margaret, Betty, Brenda. For frontline workers and healthcare professionals, those suffering from isolation, depression, or anxiety, those struggling economically. We see mounting tensions between different racial, religious, or cultural groups. Prayers for those who feel excluded or judged by society. We pray for understanding and calm. We pray for the church moving through this pandemic period with its constant changes and financial challenges. Let us join in saying the Lord's Prayer. Today we're using the second version printed on page 916 of Voices United. Eternal Spirit, earth maker, pain bearer, life giver, source of all that is and that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven. The hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen.
Be our song, no one stands alone. Let this be our song. No one stands alone, standing side by side. Draw the circle wide. Let our hearts touch far horizons, so encompass great and small. Let our loving know no borders, faithful to God's call. Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song, no one stands alone, standing side by side. Dreams we dream be larger than we've ever dreamed before. Let the dream of Christ be in us, open every door. Draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. Let this be our song.
Again, responsively. Each day we are blessed by many of God's gifts. Enable us to use them wisely, sharing them with generous hearts. We are called to be light in our world. Let us share the light that never goes out. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. We go in peace. Amen.